Hi everyone, welcome to the February Pressbooks monthly product update. I'm Steele Wagstaff, the Pressbooks product owner. So the first thing that I want to show are some changes that we recently released to Pressbooks that will affect all users. If you open up your Pressbooks user dashboard, you've always seen in this dashboard a number of like top level items, organize, book info, appearance, export, etc. Previously, if you wanted to import content, you had to go into tools and find the import option. We changed that in our latest release so that import is now a top level item, which is where I think a lot of people kind of expect to see it or would expect to find it. So now if you're in a book and you want to import content, you can just go to the top level menu item, click import, and this will show you the options for importing. If you haven't used this tool before, this is a way to get content quickly into Pressbooks from a variety of different sources. So you can import EPUBs or Word documents or open documents or XML from WordPress or Pressbooks, or even import a part of a book using our cloning routine from another URL. So just very quickly, I'll show you, you could go to Word document. I've got a document on my computer already that's ready to go. And then when you import, it will take you, when you import a Word document, it looks inside the Word document and it thinks that it's found some chapters and it will ask me which of these chapters I want to bring in. I can select them all, or I could select single chapters. And then I'm going to say, when you import it, make it public. So, or not. So I'm going to import this and you'll see pretty quickly, I've just brought in a bunch of content from the web. And here are the chapters that I've just imported from a Word document. It's here, it's in my book. And if you want to use that import tool, it's now going to be at the top level menu for users. It's easier to see and to find. But otherwise the functionality for import is about the same. So that's the first change that we wanted to share. The second one is one that I want to give special thanks to our VIP guest, Rama. Rama at eCampus Ontario, they came to us with a set of features that they thought would be really useful for their users and for everyone. And so they helped fund the development of this next thing. So thank you, Rama, and thank you, eCampus Ontario. The next thing I want to show is we've changed the cloning routine at Pressbooks. Previously, when you cloned a book, you could copy a book's content exactly and all of the media and the H5P included in it, but we never touched any of the style or display information. So now when we clone books, we will also, in addition to cloning the content, we will also attempt to clone the theme, all of the theme options, and any custom styles or custom CSS that was on the original book. So to demonstrate this, I have an example of a book that was published by the Rebus community. It's this great introduction to epistemology philosophy book. And if you look at the book, you'll notice that they're using a standard theme, but they have made some changes to this theme via CSS. So they have custom styles in place and have some theme options. When I clone this book, my clone is now going to not only have the same content, it will look identical to this book. So I'll demonstrate that here in this cloning routine. So to do that, I just grab the URL for this public openly licensed book. I come into the cloning tool. I'm going to say style demo, maybe for my title, and I'm going to clone the book. So Pressbooks will go through the cloning routine as it normally does. It says, Rebus, is there a book at this address? And Rebus says, yes, there is. It says, is it public? And it says, yes, there is. Does it have an open Creative Commons license that would allow me to make a copy and share it? And it says, yes, it does. And so then it says, okay, great. I'm creating a copy of this book on my network, and I'm going to go fetch and grab all of the content. So it will go and get the front matter, get the chapters, it will get the media, it will get the H5P activities, all of the stuff that's in the book, and that's what it's doing right now. The new thing that's going to happen is that at the end of this cloning routine, we're also going to say, tell me what was the theme that was applied in that book? And it will say, okay, here's the theme. And it says, do I have that theme on my network? If the answer is yes, it will say, okay, after you clone the book, apply that theme. And then it will say, what were the theme options? Apply those theme options. And then it will say, was there any custom CSS that the author added for custom styles? And if so, it will also apply those custom styles so that the new book will have a copy of all of those things. And then if I wanted to modify the content or the styles, I'd be starting with the same starting point as the original source book. And you can see here, if you haven't seen that before, this is a little status bar that's giving you a real-time update for what the cloning routine is doing so that you know that it didn't fall asleep or that it hasn't quit on you. And in just a moment, it's going to give me a cloning success message. It's going to tell me everything that was cloned. And then the new message that will now appear is the source book's theme settings, and custom styles were successfully applied. So if I go on my network now, here is my copy of the Rebus book. And it will now look like the Rebus book in addition to having the same content as the Rebus book. When I visit the book, go say to the analysis of knowledge, you'll remember that we have the same text boxes as before. We've got the same red kind of text box here. This book has the same appearance, has the same styles and themes. And if I want to drill in and look at that, you'll also notice that if I were to go to appearance theme options, you'll see any of the custom theme options that this book initially set. So in their book, they set the web book width to wide in web options, and that's been preserved in my book. In their book, their PDF options, they set the footnote size to 9, they set the page size to US letter. I'm going to inherit all of the PDF options that they set, and then I can modify them. And finally, in custom styles, the custom CSS that the authors at Rebus wrote for this book have now been copied verbatim into my book. For both the web book here, here's the custom CSS that they wrote, which I could then modify, replace, revise. And here's the custom CSS that they made for their PDF exports. So when I make a PDF export, my PDF export will look exactly like their PDF export, unless or until I modify this. So that's the new feature. I want to thank Rama again for funding this. And I want to especially thank Ricardo, who's here in the meeting. Ricardo wrote this, made this happen. And it was something that's been on our wish list for quite a long time. And it is very exciting to see this work. And I think you and your users will be quite pleased. So thank you, Ricardo, and thank you, Rama. The next thing that I want to show, it has to do with page view analytics. So many of you have been using Google Analytics to give you insight into how many people are visiting your Pressbooks networks or your individual books. And that works for network managers, but it's kind of cumbersome and hard if you want to share that information with your individual authors. We also know that there are some people that have concerns about Google Analytics because of its use of cookies and user tracking. And so they wanted something that was more GDPR compliant or that was better for user privacy. So what we have built is we worked with a third-party plugin called Coco Analytics to add a privacy-respecting native option for page view analytics to every network and to every book. So what I'm showing you here is a sample book from eCampus Ontario's network again. This is a very popular book. It's an introductory psychology textbook. And here on the book, you'll see in your dashboard, there's now an analytics tab. Every Pressbooks book on a hosted network that we host will now have this feature. So at the book level, you will see by default a graph that shows you how many visitors you've had over this time period, how many total page views you've had over this time period. And the real-time one is not going to be 100% accurate, but the last time we measured it would be roughly how many people were visiting every hour. And then you're going to see a graph here that shows you over the last several days, this light gray bar is the total number of page views, and the dark gray bar is the total number of unique visitors that generated those page views. So this is a visualization that's going to show you how widely viewed your book is. So in this particular case, in the month of February, 13,000 people visited, and they had 32,500 page views. And then below, there will be a table. And this table will show you the pages or the chapters which received views. So the most popular, most visited chapter in this book is the judgment and decision-making chapter. It had this many page views, 2,000 page views. The next most popular chapter was the intellectual abilities, drive states, and so forth. And finally, it will also show you a set of referrers, which is where is the traffic to this book coming from? I can see from this that of the 32,000 page views, more than half come from the same referrer. This presumably is a university website where this book is being taught. So at Queen's University in Canada, this book is probably an important part of their curriculum. That's my assumption. And you could say that's where a lot of the traffic's coming from. Google is the next most popular referrer. So Google search results are leading 2,000 people here a month. So you can scroll through and see the long tail of these things. You can scroll through and see additional pages, et cetera. The other thing that you can do is in this book, you could also change the duration. So we've only begun doing this since around the beginning of February reliably. So your stats are going to be most accurate from the start of February on. But for example, you could say, I want to see this just for the last week. So this is showing me over the last week and what it looked like over the week prior. You could also adjust this to be any custom date range that you like. So I want to see it from the 11th of through the, I don't know, the 19th. So I've got a little date picker here. And now it's going to adjust my views. It's going to adjust all my tables and gradually it will adjust the rest of the information to display here for me. That's present here for every one of your books. And this will happen and collect page view information in a way that generally respects user privacy. And it also is present at the root level of your network. The root, if you're a network manager, you'll see your root site also has an analytics page. And this is going to show me how many page views my Pressbooks network itself and its pages had. So my homepage has had 365 views, my catalog has had 30 views, and some other pages that I've built have a small number of views. And this is the tool that's that you can use to customize those things. You'll also see that there's a number of settings. So you can choose to not count page views from people who are logged in. So if you want to say, I'm an administrator on this site, I don't want to count my page views as visits, you can exclude those. You also have the option, this plugin does rely on a cookie, an anonymous cookie, which will set us some session information to know that I am the same person who is visiting those 8 pages, so that it can differentiate between a visitor and a page view. If you don't want to do that, you can turn that off. But if you do turn that off, we can't detect that the person is a returning visitor anymore. So that's up to you. Your stats will be less accurate in a certain way, but you won't have a set a user cookie. And then you also can change the default view period that you see when you load the plugin. So for me, it's 28 days, but I could set it to any one of those views if that's the view I like seeing when I log in. And if you want, you can begin deleting data from the longer than 60 day or 60 months or whatever duration you don't want to keep that page view information for. So those are the options you have. That's the feature that we built. Thanks again to Robin eCampus Ontario for funding that. And we think that that's pretty exciting and should be helpful for your users.
You said it's most accurate as of the past month or so. Is there historical data at all, or is it like just kind of wonky, or is there nothing there?
Do you mind if I go? I'm going to go back to the eCampus book and I'll show you what we have for that book, for example. In order for this plugin to collect the stats, we have to run a job on our server that goes and collects it at irregular intervals. So we don't have data before we installed the plugin, and we don't have data before we were running this at regular intervals in a reliable way. Here's what you're going to see. So we were running it pretty reliably every day from the start of January, and then we didn't run it here for a day, and then we didn't run it for 2 days. And so the January 31st page count is actually a count of all the visits that happened on the 30th and the 29th. This January 28th page count is also, you know, like, we didn't have that reliably running every day, but you will probably have some page traffic from the start of the new year until now. And what I'm saying is, now that it's officially released and working, your page counts will happen every day unless something fails on our servers.
I've been able to provide that. And I think they're more concerned about totals over time anyways than any what happens on
so day. You'll have, like, depending on when we put that, because we were working on this feature kind of like as we were released, like as it was rolling out. So you'll have some page view data probably for even as far back as October, but I wouldn't consider it like canonical until this new year.
That's fine. I think what I can tell those folks is, you know, I've already given you numbers up to a certain point, you know, I think probably earlier this month, and I'll just tell them, hey, look at the last time I emailed you, and you can add onto those, use that as a basis and do some simple math.
That makes a lot of sense to me, Mike. So the question from Ariana was, when does the consistent data start? I would say generally, Ariana, you can trust the numbers from the start of this year, and you can really trust them from the start of February. This is the, oh, I almost forgot. This is the most, not the most exciting. This is another exciting thing. And once again, this was something that was funded by eCampus Ontario. So thanks again, Rama. You are a celebrity today. So what we have done is many of you are running consortial Pressbooks networks. And so in the book info for your books, you have the ability to indicate things like title, like author, like the people who contributed. You also can indicate a publisher and a publisher city and an ISBN. And you can set a language and you can set subject terms. But many of you are serving multiple institutions and would like to indicate which university or which institution or institutions collaborated to produce a particular text. So this is largely built for those of you that are running multi-institution Pressbooks networks. So what we've done is we've now built a new feature here in Book Info where you can type in and select the institution. So suppose we have this book here. I know that John Belshaw teaches at Thompson Rivers University. So that's the first institution that I've listed. But let's say we're going to collaborate with a couple of people. So let's start with the University of Arizona. So Cheryl Neal's got a faculty member here at the University of Arizona. So I start typing Arizona and I say, okay, University of Arizona. I'm going to add that as an institution. And then let's say we've got somebody at the University of Toronto. So I start typing Toronto and I see, aha. What it's going to show you is we have added now, I think something like 4,000 institutions, all of the colleges and universities that we are aware of in Canada, the United States, and Australia. And over time, we'd like to add institutions from everywhere in the world to this list. But what we've released so far is US, Canada, Australia. And you'll see when you're typing in the phrase, you'll see a little geographic indicator that says this is the ones in Canada, Ontario. The reason that that appears is, for example, let's say I start typing Lincoln. In the United States, there's lots of different colleges or universities named after Abraham Lincoln. Many of them are HBCUs and they're in different places. So if I wanted Lincoln University, California versus Lincoln Trail College or Lincoln University, Missouri, this will help you identify which Lincoln University, Pennsylvania, et cetera. So in this case, I've added 4 institutions to Book Info. When I save those institutions, a couple of things are going to happen. The first thing that's going to happen is now on my web book homepage, this will be added to the book information down below. So just like you saw previously, there's all this metadata about the book. And now we're going to see in the metadata section, the 4 institutions that I just entered are now listed on the book's homepage. The second thing that will happen is at the network level, we have a catalog. So here, if I look at my catalog, you'll see Canadian History is one of the books. And on the book card, we will now display the institutions that were added as contributors here underneath the title. And then we'll truncate it after 2 lines because we don't have that much space on the card. And you have now a filter that would let you filter by university. So I want to see all the universities that have the university or all the books that were created by the University of Toronto as an institution. That filter will let me filter this network catalog here. So that's been released, that's available now. So if you are a consortium or running a consortial network and you'd like to begin indicating the institutions that created your books, you or your authors can add that information through the book info. Our future plans for it will be to add more institutions over time. So if you need to, if you see an institution missing that should be there, you can contact us at Pressbooks, you can contact your network manager, and we'll be adding and maintaining that list over time. The other things that we're planning to do would be to add this to the Pressbooks directory as well. So we'd like to begin filtering and surfacing information about institutions on the directory and have that be a place that people can also filter and find books by institution. For now, nobody's really added it to their metadata, but now that we've rolled this feature out, now that I'm announcing it, we do expect that people will start using it soon. Those are the big features that I wanted to share in one of the demo. I'm going to pause the recording now and I'll take any questions that people have. I want to thank everybody for attending the February product update. That's it from us this month. I hope you'll join us again next month for our next update. Thanks for all that you do for open education.